So it's
recording in progress.
Oh. Amen.
Amen. What a note to start on. Good. Well, it's been wonderful this morning so far, hasn't it? God's been speaking in so many ways, and it was just wonderful to listen to Audrey's letter, the new life that she'd got, the joy, the forgiveness, just flowed out of that letter, didn't it? And just to mention one thing, seven of Audrey's relatives made it to the funeral and came here to the wake afterwards. And just one lady would be very good to pray for. I mean, it would be good to pray for all of them. This lady had been here and been interacting with everybody. She's 90, just turned 90, this lady. She's the widow of Audrey's younger brother. And she said to Julie, she's an agnostic. And various other people in the family had said that she's hard as nails, but we didn't know that, fortunately. It's good not to know too many things, isn't it, before you meet people. But she noticed the love, she noticed the preparation, she noticed everything that had been done here. She and also one of the other relatives in particular especially mentioned the people that were working in the kitchen and all the background. They sort of noticed a lot of the things that were going on. And this lady, Chloe, said, "I'm agnostic. I don't really know whether he exists. I don't know whether he's here." And so Julie said, "Well, if I might be as bold, I think you, from what you've said, you've experienced that he is here and that he is alive." I forget all the other things Julie said. There was quite a little bit of a conversation. And this lady said, "Well, that's given me something to think about. I need to go and make a decision." She said, "I'm 90. I haven't got much time left. I need to go and make a decision." And I just wanted to bring that as a wonderful fruit. I think, amazingly, actually, she didn't hear Audrey's letter to Sally that was read out because her hearing aids were playing up and all she heard was a sort of like undersea stuff. But wonderfully, Julie had the printed version that she'd used with her at the time. She said, "Well, here it is. Go away and read it." And so let's pray that she will read that and she'll be helped in coming to a decision. So wonderful, isn't it? The fruit of what God does through these things and the way that people notice the love of serving in the kitchen, of serving in all the different ways that that you serve. So keep it up.
Did you have her name?
Yeah, Chloe. Right, I've not got my glasses. I've printed this out in 16 points, so hopefully I'll be all right. If I need to make a run for my bag, that's what I'm going for, my glasses. Matthew 22. So I want to look at Matthew 22, verses 1 to 14. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who held a wedding feast for his son. And he sent his servants to call those who had been invited to the wedding. And they were unwilling to come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, behold, I've prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fatted cattle are all butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention, and they went their separate ways, one to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized his slaves and treated them abusively and then killed them. Now the king was angry, and he sent his armies and he destroyed those murderers and set the city on fire. Then he said to his slaves, "The wedding feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. So go to the main roads and invite whomever you might find there to the wedding feast." Those servants went out into the streets and gathered together all that they found, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with dinner guests. But the king came in to look over the dinner guests. And he saw a man there who was not dressed in wedding clothes. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without wedding clothes?" And the man was speechless. Then the king said to the servants, "Tie his hands and feet and throw him into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth in that place. For many are called, but few are chosen." So here in Matthew 22, Jesus is well on in his ministry. And it says he spoke to them again in parables. So Jesus, in his last few weeks in particular, he used story after story after story to try and get people to understand, to get his point across to people so that they would hear what it's all about. In Matthew 16, it says Jesus began to predict his death. So through his ministry up to that point, he'd been doing various things. And then as he got closer and closer in the last few weeks, he was so focused on what was going to happen. And this comes through in the stories, the parables that he told. He was focusing people's mind on the things that were really important. And so just in the preceding chapters to Matthew 22, we get the stories of the hiring of the workers, where Jesus went out early in the day and got workers, and then again in midday got workers, and went right at the end of the day and still pulled in more workers and paid them all the same. We get the Jesus at the fig tree and talking about the fig tree not bearing fruit and the consequences. There's the stories of the two sons, which... not the prodigal son, but that's important actually in this context as well. But the one who said, "Yes, yes, I'll do it," and then didn't. And the other who, vice versa, was reluctant to start with, but went out and did the right thing. And then lastly, in Matthew 21, we have the story of the tenant vineyard farmers, the ones that the king gave the land and allowed them to use the land to produce wonderful produce. The only thing he wanted was a small 10%, I think it was, return. But we know in that story how they abused the people that came to them to come and collect the what was due to the owner. And in chapter 21, it says the priests and the Pharisees realized that Jesus was telling this story against them. And so that's the context for which Jesus then moves into this story about the great feast. Jesus spoke to them again in parables. And this time, I add, he says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king." So this was what was on Jesus' heart all the way through this. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is nearly here. It's coming. There's great change coming. There's something wonderful coming. Even that is only a foretaste, but what's coming is a wonderful foretaste. And so he's telling them all these things about the kingdom of heaven. And so this time he chooses the story about a great feast to bring his point home. So we've done what feasting this weekend. It was great to be able to invite all of you to come to the feast yesterday. I say feast, I'm not sure about wobbly paper plates with chili con carne slipping off the plates as you were walking through it. I don't know whether the connection between the feast you had yesterday and this feast is quite valid, but anyway, we love feasts, don't we? And Jesus loves to tell the story about this feast, because it's not only Jesus, it's not only us, but it seems the Father himself, the King, loves feasts. We see this as we go through the story. He loves feasts. And more than just a feast, this is a story about the King who is planning to hold a wedding feast for his son. Only got one son, a beloved son. And he was making this preparation for his own son to come, his own son to have many come and to be able to rejoice with him and take part in this wonderful feast. It says the king prepared a great wedding feast for his son. So you get the sense that a lot of work has been put in by this, by the king. You can sense too the great joy that the king has getting ready for this feast. And it's evident he wants a lot of people there. He doesn't want it to just be a select few. He wants masses to come and enjoy this feast. And he wants everybody that comes to be fully satisfied and to enjoy the wonderful spread that he's got for them. So in verse 3 we read, he sent his servants to call those who were invited. So far so good. He's preparing this wonderful feast. He's sending out the servants with the invitations. And then it's like there's an incredible shock in the middle of the story here, that he says that they were unwilling to come. And it's like the whole story comes to a juddering halt at this point. That it just seems incongruous, doesn't it? That this wonderful feast that should be so attractive, why would anybody not want to come? And yet, there's just that bold statement, they were unwilling to come. And it's worth just sitting back for a moment and thinking about that, isn't it? That given an invitation, why were they just unwilling to come? Verse 4, though, says, again, he sent other servants, saying, tell those who have been invited, behold, I've prepared my dinner, my oxen, and my fatted calf are all butchered, and everything's ready. Come to the wedding feast. And what comes across here is the fact that the king isn't put off by the lack of enthusiasm. If it's anything like us, would have also have been shocked and surprised that people, I was going to say take the bait, you know what I mean? You know, it's put out there, the opportunity to come, and yet they weren't interested. But he didn't get offended. He didn't give up. He continued to send more servants to go. And he persisted in calling the same people. And also, the king remained hopeful. I think that's some important lessons for us as we think about calling people. It's so easy, isn't it, to lose hope when you see apathy, when people aren't interested. I wonder what I'd have felt like as Julie was inviting you to come yesterday, and if she'd just sort of said to you, come, we're preparing lots of food, and if you, oh, okay. You know, if that was the response, you'd sort of think, all right, I'll do my own thing then. But the Father's not like that. He is persistent. He remains hopeful. He's got faith that people will come. And so he sends his servants again to the same people. And he says to them, more details this time, not just inviting them to the feast. I don't know whether he feels he needs to give them a bit of insight to excite their interest, or anyway, he then says, this is verse 4, focus my eyes in, I've prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fatted cattle are all butchered. So basically he's saying, juicy steaks on the menu, folks. It's going to be gorgeous. It's the best cuts of meat. How do you want it? Rare? Do you want it well done? Medium? There's loads of meat all for you. 16-pound steaks? No, you can have a whole plate full. It's that sort of sense that's coming out, isn't it? That there's this wonderful feast with juicy food that you just couldn't refuse. And not only talking about the deliciousness of what he's just prepared for them, it was this word that really spoke to me. He said, my oxen and my fatted cattle have all been butchered. And the king has thrown everything at this. He's not got a plan B. He's not held some of them cattle back in case they're needed for further on. He's given absolutely everything to this. And that really spoke to me again of the way that God has committed everything through his son. He'd given everything he had in his son in order to save us. He's given everything in order that we should be there at this feast. That we, as we'll see later, should be his bride, should be not only at the feast, but somehow incorporated and part of everything, part of God's heart, of what he wants. So he says, everything's ready. Come to the wedding feast. And then in verse 5, but they paid no attention. They went their separate ways. Even after he's opened his heart up fully and tried to endear them, tried to interest them, tried to pull them, they paid no interest. One went to his own farm, another to his business. And Luke goes into more details when he tells this story. He gives details about three different types of people who rejected. All of them basically had their own agenda, but for one of them it was providing for themselves. He says they purchased a field and they wanted to go and look it over. So they bought a field in order to grow crops to provide for themselves, and they weren't interested in coming to this feast to be provided for. Luke tells us of somebody who'd got their own ambitions. They bought oxen and things that they were going to use their oxen for, and they're going to try their oxen out to make sure that they were good and strong for the work they wanted them to do. And a third one Luke mentions is someone who just didn't want to join in somebody else's celebration. They'd just married and they were satisfied, and satisfied with their own celebration, didn't want to go and join somebody else's celebration. And it's just so sad, isn't it, when people have got their own agenda and they're not prepared to come and join in somebody else's pleasure. Just a little bit of Kenneth Bailey, in speaking about the Luke account, he really goes into a lot more detail about the excuses that people gave. And in the context of the civilization then, and the way that society was, that somebody who's invited people would send out an initial invitation. There'd be a lot of time while they then got things ready. And then they would send out just in the day or two before saying, right, it's ready now, come. So these people had had lots and lots of notice. And they're then coming up with excuses. And Kenneth Bailey points out how farcical the excuses are. Because for them to say, well, I've just purchased a field, they knew months, a long time in advance. And to then say, I've just purchased a field and I need to look it over, they had plenty of opportunity to work out the timing. But even more than that, he talks about the farcical nature of the excuses, that if you've just purchased a field, you then don't go and look it over after you've purchased it. Especially in the custom then, you would look in great detail into the field, whether there were stones in it, whether it was in a good position for the light to produce, and so on. You'd go into all that detail before you purchased it. You wouldn't say you'd purchased it and now you've got to go and check it out. And the same for having bought oxen. You would have looked at the oxen to see whether they pulled together properly and all that sort of stuff, whether they were strong, whether there were diseases. With horses, they check the eyes, is it? That sort of thing. Teeth, that's what they check. You see them pulling out from the horses' mouths to check that they're good to buy. You don't just buy it on a whim and then go and have a look afterwards to see if it's all right. And so Kenneth Bailey shows that actually this is a real kick in the teeth for the king who's inviting them to come. They're coming out with these excuses that they know just aren't excuses at all. They're just rubbish. So this is how they dealt with the king. And then in the next verse, in verse 6, it says that the rest seized his slaves and they treated them abusively and killed them. And when you read that, you think, why? It just seems so... I'm sure we could really look into that and there would be lots of things that we could learn. I've not done that, and I'm afraid. I've opened a window there and you can go away and think about that for yourself. So why? Why? To ignore them, almost you could sort of understand to start with. And to have legitimate excuses, you could understand. But then to come up with excuses that are just kick-in-the-teeth type excuses, there's something about man's response to God's offer that is incongruous. It's incomprehensible. But this is how it is. And one of the things I want to... I don't know if I've brought this out well enough, but it's our responsibility as God's mouthpiece to bring the message in the way that the king is wanting the message to be brought over here. In many versions it says servants, in older-fashioned versions it says slaves. Perhaps in even more modern ones it would be talking about co-workers with God or something like that, which all of them are valid. But in looking at the older versions that talked about slaves, it really brought home to me a certain point about this, which is a slave just simply has to do the bidding of the owner to the word, no questions. And I just want to bring out that point for us, that in bringing this invitation to the feast, this wonderful gospel that we've got for people, the wonderful good news that this wonderful feast has been prepared and we're to go and tell people, we are to be as slaves, we are to be slaves, in fact, not as slaves, to speak using the words that we've been given and not to feel we need to sort of change it a bit because of embarrassment or any other reason. To go to the people that he gives us to go to not lose hope, not lose heart, not to think that they don't deserve it anymore because I've given them plenty of opportunity and I'm miffed, I'm going to go and talk to somebody else now. We're to be God's slaves and to go where he wants and to speak directly. Sometimes that will not only reap indifference, which is probably one of the main things we find around us here, but many, many Christians have found that that has been, if you like, only the start of it, that what we read here of people being abused and then killed, there's plenty of Christians around the world who are treated like that for the message that they bring to others, and all they're trying to do is bring good news to other people and they're treated like that. But we have to be slaves to follow through and to do exactly what it is that God has given us to do. So it says, the king was angry, he sent his servants and he destroyed those murderers and set the city on fire. That happened in AD 70, exactly just like that, didn't it? These Pharisees and the scribes, who it says, they realised Jesus was speaking these things against them, but they didn't respond. Well, some of them didn't respond, and some of them followed through and killed Jesus. In AD 70, he did act in this way. Wonderfully, we know that it says that many of the priests after Pentecost did come into the church. But then in verse 8, we hear that he sent his servants, he sent his slaves with a new agenda. Verse 8 says, where's verse 8 gone? Anyway, he said to his slaves, the wedding feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. So this is the new agenda. Go now to the main streets, invite whoever you might find to the wedding feast. And so those slaves went out into the streets and gathered together all that they found, both bad and good. And so although the chosen people had been given time and time again the opportunity, then he sends out to everyone, to the whole world, come to the feast. Luke adds some lovely details. He tells them to go to the byways, so not just the main roads, to go round the back where people were sort of hiding. Go into the hedges. Pull people from underneath the hedges. In our context, that sort of gives... Go to the doorways at night. Find the people, the homeless, the addicts who have just got no hope, those that are the poorest in society. And so often we see, don't we, through the history of the gospel, that the floods that come in from the poorer in society, from addicts, from homeless, from people like that, people that once the good news is brought to them, suddenly they've got nothing left. And then they respond and they come in. And so with the early days of the Salvation Army, with, I forget the name of some of the organisations, many, many really poor people just respond and come in. And it's wonderful. And then in verse 10, we read, the banquet hall was full. And so the great heart of the king, that he prepared all this feast and there should be masses of people there. He's pushed out into every corner and drawn people in, and they've come. And of course, this takes us in our hearts, doesn't it, to the wedding supper of the Lamb. Let me read Revelation 19. Because this great occasion, it's been being prepared Before the clock started ticking, it's been being prepared. And then here, when the clock stops ticking, it talks about the marriage supper of the Lamb in Revelation chapter 19. I heard what sounded like. And then John, in order to try and describe it in Revelation, he has to use three different ways of trying to describe it. Because, if you like, it's just so amazing. He talks about it like the sound of a vast crowd. Or, he says, the roar of mighty ocean waves, or the crash of loud thunder. He brings these three different pictures of something that is just, you know, if you're in a large crowd and everybody starts shouting, it's astonishing. Thunder can be astonishing, can't it, Neil? And if you're in the sea, Neil again, waves crashing, it can be dramatic. And this is the sort of impression that John was getting when he was here. Praise the Lord, the God Almighty reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honour to him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb. The bride has prepared herself. She has been given the finest of pure white linen to wear. And there's just this wonderful picture of... not just picture, it's a picture of reality that he's going to be, that there is a wonderful inclusion, joining together of everybody in this feast, but all the attention is going to be on the bridegroom who's given himself and made it all possible. I wanted to go on to verse 11 onwards about the garments. There's a lot that's important about that, but I'm just going to leave it there. We'll perhaps come back to this another time. So I just want to remind you, we're invited to the feast. This is not just a lovely story. This is a story for us. If we've been invited, if we've accepted the invitation, this is an invitation for all, under the hedges, in the byways, good and the bad. So we don't just go to the bad, it's the good and the bad. All are invited. And I just want to bring God's heart to us again from this, that he doesn't give up. He doesn't get offended. I forget the scripture now, but he... bears, you can probably think of a scripture that really fits this. He bears with people time and time again, giving them opportunity after opportunity. There will be a time when the opportunity finishes, and we see that starkly in here and the consequences of it. But while there's opportunity, let's respond. Let's not ignore the invitation. If we're his servants, if we're his slaves, let's give that invitation to everybody that God gives us. And let's give the invitation clearly and straightforwardly, using his words as he's given us. So, Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the heart that we find in this. Lord, that you've given everything. Lord, all the cattle, all of your Son, Lord, you've given for this one purpose, that you want a people. Lord, you want us to be your people. And you want many others, Lord, because you want a vast crowd, a host. And so, Lord, we just want to respond to your word and to give ourselves, Lord, into your hands to bring your word to all those that you, Lord, have in your heart of hearts to come and to be part of this feast. So we just thank you. And Lord, we say with those at the great feast, all glory to you. Lord, let it be like a sound of great thunder among us, Lord, like rolling waves crashing, Lord, that we come to you and say, how great is our God. Hallelujah. Amen.